never gave up on me. You were my testimony. Hey everybody, thank you for joining me tonight for Foolproof. Sign in, let me know where you're watching from. Love to see all different places we're reaching. We're indoors tonight because of the weather. I don't think my Bible could take much more of the rain. We did it last Thursday night. We were outside in the rain. But anyway, I got something on my heart I want to share with you. And I'm going to wait, just see who else wants to sign on. Share this, tag a friend, let them know what we're doing. We're here to encourage you. We're here to help. There's a lot of people going through a lot of things. There's a lot of things going on in people's lives. And I tell you what we're going to do. Before we get started, we're going to pray. And, you know, let me know where you're watching from. But if you want to post your prayer request, post your request. And when we're done, we'll come back and pray for each one individually. There's just a lot of people going through a lot of different things. And, you know, we all face trials. We all face tribulations. Sometimes it just gets overwhelming. But the good thing is nothing overwhelms God. We serve a God that has all power. And He's in control, even though sometimes it seems like He's not. Sometimes it just seems like, where are you, God? I mean, I was in here an hour ago, just on the floor right here at the couch, just praying in my office. Didn't feel God. Feels, you know, Lord, where are you at? You know, but what He teaches us is we can't go by feelings. We have to go by faith. And we have to trust Him. Take Him at His word. He says He'll never leave you. He'll never forsake you. He says He's loved you with an everlasting love. And the enemy would love nothing more than for you to believe that God doesn't love you anymore and that God doesn't want you. That's the enemy would love that. That's the Father's thing from the truth today. So I want to go to prayer. And again, just post your prayer request. Post where you're watching from. We want to pray for the people in Nashville and Cooksville. The surrounding areas. They were hit hard by the tornadoes and devastation. You know, and then times you say, where is God in that? You know, how do you see God in all that? You know, bad things happen to good people. The simple answer, and you know, it's really not simple, but the simplest answer I can give you is we live in a fallen world, and God has a sovereign plan, and He's bringing everything, whether it be good or bad, to a point to where He can set this thing straight. The Bible says all things work for the good to them that are called, to them that love God, according to His purpose. They're called according to His purpose, them that love God. I'll get it right in a minute. It's just faith. We got to trust Him. It's all by faith. Let's pray. Father in heaven, I thank you, Lord, for the ones that are watching tonight. I thank you for those that will be watching later that's not live. Lord, I pray for Nashville. I pray for Cooksville, Tennessee. I pray for those surrounding areas. Pray for those that's lost loved ones, those that's lost property, been devastated. Lord, we lift them up to you tonight as many people are praying around the country for them. God, I pray to just strengthen them, give them a peace, that peace beyond all understanding. That peace that just surpasses, we can't even understand it, but we just have that peace through you. Lord, I pray for those that are watching tonight. There's many watching tonight that and will be watching that are going through struggles, going through a lot of things. And Lord, I just pray that you take this message, apply it to our hearts. I pray that you would prepare their hearts to receive it, prepare my heart to deliver it, hide me behind the cross. Let them see Christ high and lifted up, not me. Let them hear your voice and not mine. I give you all the praise and the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Tonight I want to talk to you out of the book of Luke, the 18th chapter. What's on my heart, you know, I was thinking about gossip. It's been on my heart all week long. gossip is a big problem. Gossip's a big problem not only in the church, but just in general in life. And if we're not careful, every day we could fall prey to that. And I believe our words have power. The Bible teaches our words have power. The Bible teaches that we're judged by our words. It teaches that God's going to bring everything we've said into account when we stand before Him. So it's really important that what we say, not only when I'm preaching, but when I'm out just doing my everyday life, that I speak life, I speak truth, I speak positive things. Even things that may come across negative, if it's in the truth, it's a positive, because we need to hear the truth. People need to understand the truth. And we need to be careful what we say. And I want to talk to you tonight about it. I think a lot of people don't realize the weight when they stare in judgmental stares or gossip. You do not realize the destructive power behind that. And I know you're thinking, oh yeah, you know, you're talking about the person I'm judging when I look at them with a judgmental glare, or the person I'm gossiping about. No, I'm speaking about you and me. Our words have power and destruction, and we'll be judged by that. And so we need to understand, when we gossip and when we judge other people, that same thing that we're putting out there is going to come right back. And we're gonna see where we're at in God. Luke the 18th chapter, starting with verse 10 through verse 14. The Bible says, two men went up into the temple to pray, the one a Pharisee and the other a publican. The Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself, God, I thank thee that I am not as that other man or other men or extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as this publican. I fast twice in the week. I give tithes of all that I possess. And the publican, standing afar off, would not lift up so much as his eyes unto heaven, but smote upon his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For every one that exalteth himself shall be abased, and he that humbleth himself shall be exalted. Now, when you look at that, a publican basically is talking about a sinner. He's talking about somebody who's ostracized from the church, had nothing to do with the things of God. You know, I don't want to get ahead of myself, but I'm going to be obedient to what the Spirit of God's leading me to say. Last night, laying in the bed, thinking about this, thinking about what we were going to talk about tonight, God impressed upon me, you know, the Pharisee didn't understand the grace of God. He did not know the God that we know. He knew the God of the Old Testament. He knew the God of wrath and judgment, and the God that, you know, and I can't explain a lot of that. I'm not gonna try to explain God, because there's things that happen in the Old Testament that blow my mind. There's things that God done that I can't understand. But the God that I'm speaking about, the same God in the Old Testament, is the same God in the New. And if we can't understand His judgment and wrath, then we'll never understand His grace and mercy. Because the love of God transcends all things. The love of God is greater than all your sin. This Pharisee had no idea of the grace and love of God. He had no idea of the mercy of God. He was about rules and regulations and doing things the way he was told to do them, and living a religious life. And there's many people today that you're caught in that same web of religion. You're trying to live a religious, structured, religious life, but there's no mercy, there's no grace, there's no joy, there's no liberty. And this man, this Pharisee, was looking at other people and judging them. No doubt when the sinner walked in, he looked over there and he's like, you know, look at that guy. He's nothing like me. You know, he's not like me. You know, interesting. The Bible said he prayed to himself. The Pharisee was praying to himself. He was his own God. Of course, we know he thought he was praying to God, but the Bible clearly says he prayed to himself. God, I thank you that I'm not like other people. I thank you that I'm not like that cat over there, standing over there with his head down. I thank you that I'm not like the addict or the alcoholic or the adulterer or that prostitute or that liar, that cheater, that corrupt person. I thank you, Lord, that I'm not like none of them. And God is looking at us and saying, there's none righteous, no, not one. There's none perfect. There's none that do good. There's none that seek after Him. None. It's the goodness of God that we have that's good in us. If we have any good at all, it's Christ in us. It has nothing to do with our works, nothing to do with how we act, what we say, what we do. It's all about Jesus. And that's what I want to get to tonight. Jesus said, verily I say unto you, that the publican and the harlots go into the kingdom of God before you. Whoa. Prostitutes and sinners go into the kingdom of God before religious people. That's what Jesus was saying in Matthew. And that's a hard pill for a lot of religious people to swallow, because there's this thing where we think if because we go to church or we live a religious life, we're moral, maybe you're just a good person, you're moral, you treat people right, you're fair in business, you live to a godly standard, that's not good enough. You can't make it to heaven living that way. You can't live good enough to earn God's grace. You can't live bad enough to spurn His grace. God's grace is given freely. It's given because He wants to give it, not because we earned it or deserve it, but because He's God. We can't deserve it. We can't do enough to earn it. We can't live strict enough lives to keep it. And that's the web. That's the web of religion. And the people that get caught up in this, the people that think they're living that way and they're living this religious hard life, are very bitter, very angry, very judgmental, and are the first ones to gossip about someone that's struggling with maybe an addiction or stuff, someone that's struggling with alcohol or pornography, or someone that's just in general struggling in life for whatever reason. They're very quick to judge now and to gossip. And the reason they do that is because that gives them a pleasure to think that someone might be worse off than they are. But right here in the scriptures I just read you, they're not. The religious person is worse off than the prostitute, than the sinner. The religious person, the person that's put all their confidence in how they can earn it, how they can deserve it. And why is that? Because a lost person, a sinner, someone that's out there, knows exactly who they are, knows exactly that what they need, whether they come to Christ or not, that's a whole nother story. But they know that they're lost. And they know, why do they know? Because we all have this emptiness inside of us. Every one of us. I've said this before. There's a desire to know God. There's a desire to be loved by God. But there's also a desire to live like hell. There's a desire to do the things that are fun and crazy and wild. But all those things are temporary and they never satisfy. And you always have to do more and do more. But when you get the peace of God in you and you know that God loves you, you know that He's with you, then when you're laying on the couch praying and you don't feel Him, or you're out in the woods somewhere by alone and you're praying you don't feel Him, or at your job and everything's going bad at my job or your job, and you're saying, man, where is God? Look at all these people that live like hell that are being blessed. God is saying, don't gossip. Don't judge. Don't look at them. That's a Pharisee view. What we need to do is glorify Him in whatever state we're in. Pray and ask God to help us be content in whatever state we're in. Sinners know they need a Savior. Religious people have fooled themselves into believing that they've got all they ever need and they're exactly where they need to be in Christ, or in God, rather. And, you know, I don't think someone can come to Christ because they just decide, you know, it's the right thing to do. And I know a lot of people don't like, I've had preachers that have gotten upset with me because I said, I don't think you didn't choose God. You didn't decide one day that you're going to go and be a Christian. Oh, yes, I did. No, you didn't. God chose you. God's Holy Spirit came to you and showed you that you're lost. Without the Spirit of God, you don't know what state you're in. Without God drawing us to the cross, we'll never know how we stand before God. I don't know about you. I have no idea what your experience was, and I'm not saying you have to have the same experience that I had in salvation. But I can promise you, my experience was, oh, wretched man that I am. I'm nothing that I thought I was. I realized, God, I'm unworthy. I'm broken before you. How could you forgive me for all I've done, the things I've done? How could you have mercy on me? I can relate to this publican who couldn't even lift up his eyes and pray, but just smote his breast. I'm a sinner. And so when that happens, that's because the Spirit of God has quickened us and let us know that we need a Savior. The Bible says he prayed to himself. What was his great sin? It was pride. Religious pride. The Bible says God resists the proud. Many people wonder why they struggle so much. Why does it seem like the enemy's always winning in my life? Why does it seem like God is not really moving in my life? Could it be pride? Could it be that we have a religious pride? Because God resists that. Look, God's not a liar. If his word says it, that's the way it is. And if God resists us because of pride, The only way we're going to have God come in and work in our lives is to get the pride out, to confess it before God. Lord, I'm prideful. And look, I'm prideful. I'm egotistical. One of the sure tell signs that you're prideful is believing you're not. If you really think that you have no pride, my friend, you're worse off than I am. I know I've got pride. I can admit it. But there was a time when I thought I had that whipped. And God showed me, your flesh is always going to draw you to be prideful, because that's what happened to Satan. He was prideful, and he's the god of this world. He's that force that's working in this world, trying to kill, steal, and destroy. And he always operates through the pride of life, lust of the flesh. He's always working, trying to deceive. The Bible says, if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. He said the Pharisee prayed to himself. Why did he pray to himself? He had iniquity in his heart. God's not hearing his prayer. He was full of himself, full of pride, and God saw it. The Bible says, if any man think that he knoweth anything, he knoweth nothing, yet as he ought to know. A lot of people think they've got everything figured out. A lot of people try to put God in a little box and say, I know this God. I've got God figured out. If you could figure God out, you'd be God. God is way above us. His thoughts are not our thoughts. His ways are not our ways. God is not asking you to try to figure him out. God is asking you to be obedient to him and his will, because God wants to work through you. He wants to receive the glory, and he wants you to see the power of him inside of you working in these last days. Jesus said that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you shall in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven. Think about that. What was a Pharisee? They fasted twice a week. They prayed. You know, I read to you, the Bible says that they tithed. He tithed everything, 10%. He not only tithed his money, but he tithed his garden, his herbs, everything they had, they gave 10% of it. They were very religious, very dedicated. They thought being religious made them better. They thought that was the badge of honor. And a lot of times when people come into a church or a religious gathering or a whatever we want to call it, when they come to that and they're looking for hope, a lot of times they feel judged. They feel like they're not good enough to be there. And my friend, it should never be that way. You know, when we look at the New Testament, people ran to Christ. They came to where he was at. Jesus went to them. I think about the demoniac. That's one of my favorite scriptures I preach on a lot. Mark 5. This man had no hope. Nobody wanted anything to do with this man. He was in the tombs by himself, cutting himself day and night, full of demons. Just cried all night. The Bible says every day he cried. He just cried. He was lonely. He was destroyed. He had no hope. Christ went out of his way to help this man, to deliver this man. And that's how we're supposed to be. We're supposed to walk in the same power and in the same authority. That where we go to help. We go to bring salvation and deliverance through the gospel, through the word of God. We carry the truth. We carry the most powerful force on this planet, the spirit of the living God, pushing behind us and in us and through us, preaching the word of God or sharing your testimony. That's power. When this Pharisee started talking about this other man and other people, I'm glad I'm not like them, then he exposed his heart to God. He exposed, which God already seen it, but he exposed his heart to us. The Bible says, if any man among you seem to be religious and bridleth not his tongue, but deceives his own heart, this man's religion is in vain. Many people speak their opinion and speak what they believe is right before they really think about it, before they really let it run through the gates of, is this the truth? Is this full of grace and love? Is this going to help anyone? And look, y'all, I'm going to have to be honest with you. I'm guilty. There's been times when I've been hard. There's been times on here I've got people that I probably are, you know, still have a problem with some of the things I've said because I come off the wrong way. And God dealt with me about that. Telling the truth is what we're supposed to do. But it's the truth in love. And when you offer the truth of a problem, we need to offer the solution to that problem. And it's always through love. God is love. If we're doing anything outside of love, then we're not working in God. We need to know that. My experience with salvation when I was born again was the love of God, a love that I still have never gotten over. And that love is, I believe, in heaven, is perfected in us, and I believe it's something that is indescribable, that we'll live in for all eternity. Love, belonging, security. And that's what he wants us to have. That's what he wants us to live with, and that's what he wants us to share. Jesus said, "For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks." Listen, when you're talking to someone, you can let them talk for a while. Eventually, you'll see what's in their heart. It's going to come out. You know, people say a drunk man always tells the truth, because when they get drunk, their inhibitions are lowered and they just speak from the heart. You know, I believe there's a lot of truth to that. But see, if you let somebody talk long enough, that heart's going to start speaking. And that's what he's saying. He said, the Bible says, "Every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment." That's scary to me. That scares me. Because I've said a lot of things I shouldn't have said. I have spoken a lot of things I shouldn't have spoken. I've cussed. I've gotten mad. I'm talking about since I've been saved. I mean, I've said things I shouldn't have said. I've said things about people. I've talked about people. I've said, I've gossiped. I've done it. And right here it says, "Every idle word I'll give account thereof in the day of judgment. For by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned." You know, I thank God that even though I have failed him, even though I fail every day, even though there's no way I can live good enough to please him in my flesh, that I'm born again, I'm forgiven, because Christ loves me, and my faith is not in my religious abilities, not in a denomination, not in my church attendance, not in my morality, not in my good nature. My faith alone is in Jesus Christ and the finished work on the cross. When he hung on that cross between heaven and hell, he conquered all sin, conquered the grave, conquered it all. And when his blood was spilling all over the ground, that precious holy blood of the Savior, it wasn't holy water, it was holy blood. And that holy blood covers all sin. All sin. I don't care who you are watching tonight, what you've done. You may have never seen me do a video, just you may have watched 100 of them. Whatever, listen to me. God's love is greater than your sin, and God's blood is holier than the most evilest, vilest thing you've ever done. God's not afraid of you nor your sin. God commanded all men everywhere to repent. He's saying, turn from your sin. Turn and come to me. Not because it's a club, not because I want you to sign up on a church somewhere, but because I want your soul to be saved. I want you to be born again. I want to fill you with my Holy Spirit. I want to give you power. I want to set you free. Then you can go and be a part of the church. Then you'll be a part of the church. And that's what he wants you to have tonight. The Bible says, "Keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of that are the issues of life. Put away from thee forward mouth, perverse lips put far from thee." In other words, quit talking smack about people. Quit putting people down. Quit being so forward. And again, if you think I'm talking, putting anybody down, I'm talking to David. I'm very opinionated. I'm strong-willed. And I shoot my mouth off when I shouldn't. And there's been many times I've had to go and apologize because of what I've said and because of shooting my mouth off. There's been times when I've held back, thank God, and a few hours later was so thankful that I didn't say what I wanted to say. I didn't do what I wanted to do because it would have hurt my testimony. It would have changed a lot of things. You need to be very aware. The enemy's cunning. The enemy's very crafty. He's very manipulative of our emotions. He knows what your buttons are. And he'll find somebody close to you. He'll find somebody that you're not expecting to come by and blindside you and just completely knock you off. And when that happens, you have to react. There's a reaction, and that reaction has to be in love. And I know that sounds so hypocritical. It does to me, because a lot of times I want to come up swinging. I'm going to be honest with you. I have people that come against me on these videos. I get messages y'all don't know about. We get hate mail, death threats. Used to get a lot of death threats. I haven't gotten none lately. But the bottom line is this. I'm a fighter by nature. I'm not a coward. I want to go to you and handle some business. That's how I am. But you know what? That don't work good with ministry. God's looking for humility and meekness. And when you look up meekness and humility in the dictionary, there's not a picture of me. And so I need more meekness. I need to be more humble. And the only way I'm ever going to get that is by prayer and staying in the Word of God. Because you can't be a man of prayer, a woman of prayer, and be prideful. If you stay in prayer, it'll humble you. It'll help you. It'll help you become meek. Because the closer you get to God, which is how we get close to God, through the Word and through prayer, the more we see our imperfections and that we don't have this thing figured out. The Bible says, be sure your sins will find you out. You know, this Pharisee looked at that sinner. He thought, hey man, that guy's on pills. That guy smokes weed. He's got three or four girlfriends on the side. All this stuff. But how many sins did this Pharisee have in his life? What was in his life? Be sure your sins will find you out. It's easy to throw a rock at somebody. It's easy to put somebody down that's had a great moral failure, some kind of scandal in their life. It's easy to jump on them. There's been preachers on Facebook that's had scandals. And everybody wanted to bail and jump on them. But you know the truth is, we're supposed to try to help each other. We're supposed to try to lift each other up. And we need to be careful, because when we start coming against people, we start throwing rocks. We live in glass houses. We don't have no business throwing a rock at nobody. Because who am I to judge you? Who are you to judge me? The Bible says, know you not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Be not deceived. Neither fornicators, idolaters, adulterers, effeminates, nor abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. And such were some of you. But you are washed, but you are sanctified, you are justified in the name of our Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. In other words, heaven's full of a lot of messed up people. Heaven's going to be a place where when we walk them streets, that we see people on the street, and nobody, not one person, deserves to be there. Not one person is standing in heaven, seated in heaven, in their mansion going, yep, I did it my way, I made it. No, that's the theme of hell. I did it my way. That's the way they sing down there. That's the theme of hell. Hell's anthem is I did it my way. In heaven, glory to the Lamb of God. You deserve all the praise and all the glory. We'll sing praises to Him. We'll glorify Him. Why? Because He did it for us. He lived the life for us because He loves us. In verse 12, the Pharisee said, I fast twice a week. I give tithes all that I have. Jesus said, woe unto you scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye pay tithe and mint and anise and cumming and have omitted the weightier matters of the law, judgment and mercy and faith. That word judgment really means justice. Justice and mercy and faith. These ought you to have done and not to leave the other undone. You blind guides, which straining a gnat and swallow a camel. Woe unto you scribes and Pharisees and hypocrites. I grew up in a situation in a church that I went to. And look, I'm not picking on that church because I think there's a lot of churches that have the same problem. But they would swallow a gnat, swallow a camel and strain on a gnat. Case in point, divorce. Divorce is an issue. It's a real issue. Now, my situation was when I was divorced before I was ever born again. I was lost as a bat. Got married, lost the second time. I mean, and I got born again. So everything I've done before then is under the blood. And there's other circumstances and situations for divorce that's biblical. God, it's not God's will that we get divorced. It's not God's will that we marry people that are unbelievers. But look, I was an unbeliever, lost. The bottom line is this, God saved me and called me. But the church I grew up in doesn't believe I could be a preacher. The whole denomination believes because I've committed the unpardonable sin of divorce, I'm no longer qualified. But just pay your tithes, make sure you bring your money, sit on the pew, and go home. Well, that's good for somebody that's not saved. That's good for somebody that just wants to punch in church. I'm in the Pharisee. I made it. I done it. I'm out. I'm going to go do what I want to do. But when you're full of the Spirit of God and God's called you, that it doesn't work. It doesn't sit well. And so through God's providence, he started using me, and I started preaching in other places, and eventually ended up preaching in that very denomination and had one of the fastest growing churches at the time. I was pastoring a small church at the time I pastored. God blessed. God multiplied. God made a point to me and to others. And here's the thing. When God calls you to do something, there ain't a devil in hell that can stop it. There ain't a religious Pharisee or scribe that can stop it. There ain't nobody that can say anything about your past that's going to hinder God. God's not going to go, oh my God, I didn't know you done that. Such and such was praying to me the other day and they told me what you done. Really? God knows everything. God sees everything. When he hung on that cross, he saw who you are, what you were, what you were going to be, what you were going to do. And he loves you anyway. And when he saved you and called you out of that sin, man will hold it against you. Man won't forget. But God says, I cast it as far as the east is to the west, never to be remembered again. Most gossip today that comes from religious people comes back to people's past, judging them by their past. Well, you know what she used to be, and she's wanting to do that, and she's trying to take that position here. And you know, we know what she was, or we know what he's all about. We better look at ourselves. The Bible says, not by the works of righteous, which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us by the washing and regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost. We don't earn it. You can't work it. You can't make it happen. Which to shed on us abundantly, he has shed on us abundantly through Jesus Christ, our Savior, that being justified by his grace, we should be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. For by grace are you saved through faith. And that not of yourselves, it's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. I said it a while ago. You won't meet no one in heaven. There'll be not one person you'll meet in heaven, but Christ is the only one that can walk them streets and say, I did it my way. I made it. Everybody's there by the grace of God, the Lamb of God who gave himself for the sins of mankind, seated on the right hand of glory is why we'll be there. And we'll give him honor and praise. Braggers and hypocrites, won't be none in heaven. Now, if you're a bragger and a hypocrite tonight, and you repent and turn from that, then that you can be in heaven. But there'll be nobody up there bragging about what they've done. There'll be no hypocrites up there. It'll be completely transparent and true and honest. It's a turnoff to people. A bragger and a hypocrite are turnoffs not only to people, but it's a turnoff to God. This Pharisee was bragging on himself. He was a hypocrite. The Bible says, seest thou a man wise in his own conceit? There's no hope for a fool. There's more hope for a fool than for him. The Bible's saying a fool has more hope than somebody that's wise in his own pride, his own abilities. We'll never earn it. We'll never deserve it. And there's nothing we can do to make God change his mind. I for a long time, after I got saved, I wondered about it. I thought, now, is there a chance that I could lose this? Is there a chance that God's going to change his mind about me? Am I going to wake up one day unsaved? Am I going to do something stupid? I did. I did a lot of things stupid. But thanks be to God who did it for me. And God loves me today. God loves you. And there's none of us that can say we weren't there or we didn't sin or we didn't. We all have skeletons, every one of us. So who are we to gossip? Who are we to put somebody else down? The Bible says, and you hath he quickened, you and me. He quickened us who were dead in our trespasses and sins. Wherein in times past you walked according to the course of this world. We did the things, we did it like we wanted to do. We partied, we lived it up. According to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom we also all had our conversations. Every one of us had our conversations in this in times past. The lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath he quickened us together with Christ. By grace you are saved. And he hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. For all eternity, God will show his grace and riches through us because we'll be there because of his grace and his mercy through Christ. Job said, if I justify myself, my mouth condemns me. If I say I'm perfect, it shall also prove I'm perverse. We can't take credit for what he's done, but we can give him praise and glory for it. Every way of a man is right in his own eyes, but the Lord pondereth the heart. Proverbs 21:2. A lot of people feel like they've got things figured out. You're doing it the right way. That's why we have denominations. That's why we have division. We have all this other stuff. I'm not going to get on that tonight. But every man thinks he's got it right in his own eyes. What we need to look at is, what does the Bible say? What does the Word of God say? Because that's what we'll be judged on. That's the only thing that really is going to stand and really matters, is the Word of God. In verse 13, that publican said, be merciful to me, a sinner. Now you got one guy over here going, praying to himself, I'm glad I'm not like this other guy. I'm glad I'm super religious guy. I'm glad I got it all figured out. Keep in mind, this man has no idea about grace. He doesn't know the mercy and grace of God. But he's living a religious, strict, religious life. And on the other side, you've got a publican, a sinner, who's humbled and says, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. Jesus loves sinners. Jesus loves humble sinners. The Holy Spirit of God is what humbles a sinner. And unless you're humbled by the Spirit of God and brought to a place of repentance, you cannot be saved. It's not about making a decision. It's not about saying a prayer. It's about acting on it. When the Spirit of God draws you, you come. You come then, because he's drawing you. And he's wanting to make something dead alive and new. Your spirit, your soul, he wants to regenerate you and make you alive. They that are whole, Jesus said, they that are whole need not a physician. But they that are sick, I came not to call the righteous. I haven't come to call that self-righteous person, that Pharisee, that religious person, but sinners to repentance, which they are too. Sinners. He came for the sinner. Jesus said, joy shall be in heaven over one sinner that repents more than over 99 just persons who need no repentance. If you want to ring the bells of heaven, you want heaven to rejoice, win somebody to Christ. Every time someone's saved, there's more rejoicing over that one person than 99 people that are praising God that don't need salvation. That's how we ring the bells of heaven. The Bible says, Jesus said, for the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which is lost. He went everywhere he did doing good, Jesus did, bringing salvation and deliverance. And we should be doing the same thing. Now, I don't know if this is going to go with this. I'm getting ready to close, but this has been on my heart too. A lot of us have no power in our lives. We have spiritual warfare going on. There's a lot of problems. I'm not saying that it's all gossip. I'm not saying it's all pride, but I'm not saying it's not either. There could be some gossip. There could be some pride, some judgmental attitudes in us that's keeping us from experiencing the fullness of God. And we need to make sure that we know Christ, that we are who we say we are in Christ. This Pharisee thought he knew God. He didn't have a clue who God was. And we need to understand that we're fighting a real fight, y'all. This ain't a game. It's real life. And there's a real enemy out there. There's a real devil. He's wanting to destroy you. He's wanting to destroy your family. And you have to have the goods. You have to have the power. And God impressed upon me to close with this. In Acts 19, there were 7 men that were watching Paul cast out demons and seeing Paul do great works. And these guys were exorcists. That's what they were known to be, exorcists. I guess they just probably had a little office set up somewhere. Come to us. We're exorcists. We'll help you. I don't know. But the Bible says that they went and this man that had demons in, or had a demon in him, and they said, we adjure you by the God, by the Jesus whom Paul preaches, come out of that man. The Bible says that the demon looked at them men, 7 of them. He says, Jesus I know, and Paul I know, but who are you? And that man, the demon-possessed man, jumped on them 7 guys, whipped them, took their clothes, and they ran off naked. Now, the whole point is this. He knew who Paul was. He knew who Jesus was. But he had no clue who these guys were. How many people today are casting judgment, gossip, putting other people down. And not only are you not saved, not only are you not living right, you're just religious, but the enemy don't even know who you are. You're so far away that even the devil don't even know who you are. I want to be known in hell. I want him to know who I am. I want to do enough for my Savior, my God, that when I serve the Lord, that I'm not some anonymous person, because I serve in power and authority. And when we gossip, we're prideful and we're separated from God, that's a sign that we're not living right, and it could be a sign that we're not even saved. Many people are struggling today. He may not know me. The enemy might. He might not, but he knows who my daddy is. He knows who my father is. And you need to make sure you know who your father is. You need to make sure you're a child of God. The Bible says, for as many are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. For you have not received the spirit of bondage, again to fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father, my daddy. The Spirit itself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, distress, persecution, famine, nakedness, peril, sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. If you're his child, then a devil in hell can take you away from him. If you're not his child, you need to make it right tonight. You need to get right with him. If you're gossiping, you're judging other people, and this message is hitting you right between the eyes, the first thing I ask, are you religious? Are you caught up in a religious system? You're a member of a church somewhere, you might be serving, but you've never been born again. You never had that experience with God. You never had a life-changing experience. Most of what I said tonight didn't really resonate because you don't understand. You don't understand the love of Christ. You don't understand what I'm reading when you can't be separated from his love because you don't know his love. But you can. You can know his love for you. You can know how great his love is for you. The Bible says he giveth more grace. Wherefore he saith, God resists the proud but giveth grace to the humble. If you're humble tonight and you're coming in humility, God will hear you. God will hear your prayer. If that Pharisee would have humbled himself like the publican, God would have heard his prayer. God would have helped that man. The Bible says, draw nigh to God and he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. The Lord is nigh to them that are of a broken heart, and saveth such as of a contrite spirit. That man had a broken heart, the publican, and a contrite spirit. I ask you tonight, through this message we've done, I hope you've been blessed. I hope God has spoken to your heart through it. Make an effort. I'm going to make an effort tomorrow and every day to speak life and speak truth and not to be judgmental, not to be hard, and not to be a gossiper. And look, everybody we meet, everybody on this planet has a soul, each and every one. And each one is just as precious to God as yours is to God. The Bible says, what will it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? Every soul is worth more than this entire world to God. And if it's that valuable to God, it should be that valuable to us. Whoever comes in your church, whoever comes in your group or your presence, the last thing they need is to be offended by gossip or a judgmental stare. They need to be welcomed in by the love of God, of Christ in us. And the way we do that is remember where we were at and where he found us and what he did in our lives. Let the words of our mouth, the meditation of our hearts, be acceptable in his sight. O Lord, our strength and our redeemer, in Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.